det lyser med en fantastisk intensitet opp til en megawatt. Har det vært beregnet at dette det her lyser ut? Det lyser lenge. Hvor i all verden er ledningen da? Hvor er drivstofftanken som klarer å få dette her til å lyse? Det er like stort som et hus nå da.
Hesdalen. This remote mountain valley in Norway, 30 kilometers north of the mining town Røros, has a population of only 120. There was once four times as many people living here, but today many homes are empty. But why is there a blue container placed far up on one of the hillsides, with cameras covering the valley? Is there something going on in Hesdalen of an unusual character?
The light phenomena here in Hesdal in Norway started in late 81, well, with a lot of sightings. At the most it was 20 sightings a week. The local people here started to see the light down in the valley, sometimes close to their houses, and they was wondering what could this be, and there was, some was a little bit afraid too, because no one could give them any answer. What could it be? And this was became known for the public through newspapers, etc. And people started to go up here and see if they could see it for themselves. And many people did.
Men da sto vi en 30-40 personer og kikket. Og plutselig kom da dette lyset gjennom skydekket og ned langs fjellsiden. Og stoppet rett foran oss og seg forbi. Og vi fulgte dem med blikket, og nede i dalen lenger frem sto det et lys og ventet på den. Og i det øyeblikk falt jo alle mine teorier om fly, meteoritt, kulelyn. For det første var det jo ikke noe lyd fra dette her.
A long oval-shaped light phenomenon appeared to be landing. It came up the valley along the mountainside, stopped and rotated slowly.
Så reiste den seg opp, så den står som en stake oppe på fjellet. Og da var det akkurat som når du ser inn i sola, så ser du en silhuett inn i det lyset.
This picture is taken with 1/60th of a second exposure.
The phenomena behaves very different. Some is moving very slowly, and some lights can move very fast. The fastest speed we have ever measured was 30,000 kilometers an hour. And we have also recorded the slower speed. We have also recorded on the radar something moving without being seen by a light, so it's invisible, but it's a strong recording on the radar, so it's actually there is something which is moving around.
Ja, Hesdalen som du ser innover her slik, den cirka en 15 kilometer lang. Den ikke så veldig stor da, men så har du en fjellside i på øst og fjellside i vest. Det har jo vært mye mot disse fjellene som dette har blitt sett veldig mye da.
Many strange photos were taken of the phenomenon during the first years. The lights were difficult to capture on film due to long distances and rapid movements in the dark. Even on short exposures down to 1/100th of a second, the lights covered a large area of the film. What kind of lights would behave this way, night after night, in this harsh environment?
I 84, tror jeg, på denne tida på året, var vi nå lekt oss inn på låven her, og kom ned ut i utgangsdøra, så registrerer vi et eller annet som står overfor oss. Og det er et lys som vi står og ser på, som står og funkler sånn som det her. Og det er blågrønt, og det står og, ja, en cirka 5-10 sekunder. Det virker som en evighet, og så plutselig så, husk, så drar det bortover vestover. Jeg følte ingen frykt, men tenkte jeg kanskje at det var så heldig at jeg kunne såpass titt innpå det. For før så hadde jeg sett på avstand, kan jeg si, på mange kilometer. Det kom med sånne runde kuler som kunne glidende innover dalen, og etter hvert så ble det så vanlig at det var ikke gjort lenger. Men her var mye mer spennende, for det var mye nærmere.
There were many efforts to explain these phenomena. Could it be aeroplanes, or the light from a distant railroad reflected in the sky, or maybe ball lightning, or was it satellites, planets, or meteors? But the speed and the way the light moved, often beneath the treetops, eliminated all such explanations. The phenomenon remained unexplained.
Det som er det rare med det lysfenomenet her, er at det har så mange forskjellige typer observasjoner. Det er nesten så vi kan dele inn i kategorier. Og en type kategori er hurtige lysglimt, som ofte kan være vanskelig å se på grunn av den korte tiden som de varer. Men de er sterke, så det blir registrert på film og så videre. En annen type kategori er store lysfenomener som på en måte går sakte rundt omkring, som kan vare timesvis. Og en tredje type kategori er vel mer hvor du har flere lyspunkter samlet på en måte, som varierer, slokker, tennes og så videre, sånne ting. Det er jo de hovedkategoriene, kan du si. Og så har du andre typer også, som det ikke er blitt observert så mange av, da. Men som også er, kanskje må tas med inn i bildet. Så utseende oppførselen er ganske forskjellig, vil jeg si, mellom de kategoriene, og som gjør det selvfølgelig vanskelig å finne en løsning.
Three main categories of light. But the fourth category, what was that? Was there more to this than only lights? After a while, brave locals came forward and told of other observations, including large solid objects.
Ja, jeg har sett to forskjellige variasjoner.
Ja.
Den ene er blank og oppløst.
Ja.
Og den andre er mer som sigarformet, og er oppløst i begge hendene med en svart parti, en mørkt parti midt på.
Beveger det seg?
Ja, i forskjellige hastigheter. Og det hender seg jo at det stopper opp og står.
Ja, på Vårhus er det i grenn lenger borte. En Åge skulle vei gå og kjøre tømmer ned på elven der en kveld, med snøskuttere. Så jeg skulle vei følge og hjelpe meg også, for det var mot. Så jeg skulle vei rulle det tømmerstokkene på plass, ja, og det gjorde det. Så jeg sette meg opp på tømmerstokkene og koset meg der til månskjene med en røk og det, og satt og stirret. Og der fikk jeg så det kom i lys ifra sø. Helt stilt, det var ingen lyd eller noe. Og det kom Emilia med og det granen der. Og det gikk noe langt unna der jeg var. Og det var to lys på det der som kom, men jeg så det var en farekost, altså. Det var, ja, du kan tenke deg til i kneipbrød som er flatt på ned, og så at det kuves opp slik. Så var det ikke lys nemme frem på der, og ikke vite den oppa. Så det var ikke noe fly, det, nei. Men hva det var, det vet ikke vi enda.
Med bevitnes på at vi har sett det, så er det 68 observasjoner. Og det er nedskrevet, ja.
Og når var de siste observasjonene?
11. juni.
nå i 2006. Og det var ca. 30 varmegrader i sola den dagen. Og helt klar himmel, og da så vi som en sylinder over fjellet her. Men så rare med det, den observasjonen, det var at sola skjedde ikke på der sylinderen på sørsida, der hun skulle skjedde, men på nordsida, der det skulle være skygge.
Jeg kjørte opp med bussen om morgenen når hun var halv åtte, tenkte jeg, oppover her, Hestdalslia, innover mot Hestdalen ifra åren da, her. Og jeg var alene i bussen, og så når jeg kom nesten opp på toppen, så fikk jeg da se at det kom en lysende gjenstand. Det var jo på våren det her, men det var liksom en liten soloppgang, så at jeg så det glinsa i metallet på det der fartøyet eller sånt da. Det var som luftskipet Norge, kan jeg si da. Det var en sånn formasjon som det var, vi vet jo aldri hvordan det så ut. Det gikk og forsvant da mot det nord, men det gikk inn i atmosfæren liksom på en måte.
Så får jeg så et blinkende lys innover Hestdalen. Stod med speidet og så på her, plutselig så kommer det med en gjenstand. Da sto jeg og beskuet dem der på ca. 300 meters avstand. Det var så mye spøkelsesfly. Sølv metallikk hadde et blinkende rødt lys fremme. Og så var det to blanke lys som sto loddrett oppå hverandre bak da. Det var formet omtrent som en pistolkule, kan si en 9 mm pistol.
Jeg kan fortelle dere, men vinterkveld, ja det var i februar-mars. Og så når jeg kom opp av Hestdalslia da, så var det noe mørkt. Men når jeg kom mest opp på toppen, opp på kjøren der som vi ser, der var det opplyst rundt meg. Det var det opplyst om dagen. Så kom det nå og for over bil. Det var som en opplyst herrehatt. Gammeldags slik stor herrehatt med brenn på det. Som for over bil og fremover. Jeg så skogen oppe i Rognefjellet og alt. Ja, det var rart skal jeg si det å se. Så at dere kjørte i mørket og så plutselig ble opplyst rundt det.
These reports had the characteristics of classic UFO observations, leading to massive resistance against the phenomenon in the media. The local people in Hestdalen were soon being ridiculed.
Vi ble fryktelig latterliggjort. Det var vanskelig å reise enn i hovedbygden i Åla på handel.
Og da, det var bakgrunnen for at vi gjorde de første undersøkelsene allerede i 84. Hvor vi da hadde instrumenter her oppe, og fikk gjort målinger når dette fenomenet var her.
A small group of enthusiasts from UFO organizations in Norway and Sweden conducted the first investigations, partly supported from a university and with equipment from the military. Electromagnetic measuring equipment, low-frequency radio receivers, cameras and radar were mounted on a proper site with a good overview. Would it be possible to capture the phenomenon with this equipment? If so, this would be the evidence many were waiting for. And in the first winter in 1984, 53 observations were made during a month. These reports were so astonishing that one of the world's foremost UFO researchers, Dr. J. Allan Hynek, arrived in Hestdalen to see for himself. He was the former scientific advisor for UFO studies undertaken by the U.S. Air Force under the name of Project Blue Book.
And I'm impressed with Hestdalen itself because Hestdalen is really a UFO laboratory. It's a place where things are happening and where things can be studied.
Well, once we used a laser to point to the phenomenon when it showed up, and it reacted. Well, it was at that time a flashing light, and when we pointed the laser beam to it, it changed the flashing frequency. It doubled the flashing frequency, And we take it down again, and it went back to regular flashing. And we did this test 9 times, and in 8 of those 9 times, it changed the flashing frequency.
Powerful lights with unusual movements, observations of craft-like objects, and responses to laser beams. What kind of phenomenon was this? And still even more peculiar reports were to emerge. In 1984, in a small valley connected to Hessdalen, 3 moose hunters are starting their day. What they are about to find can definitely not be explained as seeing things.
Laget var på elgjakt og går ut fra hytta inn I ledaren om på morgenen I god tid på formiddagen. Og når vi har gått I stund så plutselig kjenner jeg at myra har begynt å bevege seg under meg. Vi er oppmerksom på at det utskjer I viss form I torvet der. Jeg begynner å undersøke litt mer om det der, og straks ved siden der ser jeg at det opptatt I torvet av samme format. Men der sto hølet tomt. Og 4-5 meter lenger inn på tørrrabben der, det lå torva. Nedsatt. Akkurat slik som hun var opptatt. Ingenting var dødt I torv eller noen ting. Skjer I helt rene kanter. Og den der giften av tjukkelse på torven da, mellom 35 og 40 centi. Og så blod et mye, så det der vi har nok ville vært inn. Ja, anslår det man slår ut en halvannen til 2 tonn. Og gå dit en par timers gange uansett til går ifra, minst. Og ikke det finnes ikke spor I hele tatt. Så det ikke med menneskelig makt uten å tenge redskapet og løfte den der.
What has the ability to cut out a piece of soaking wet turf weighing 2 tons and place it undamaged 5 meters away? The tree roots in the turf are cut with razor blade precision.
Det der bildet nå ble tatt om våren etter vi fant det om høsten. Men det vises nå likevel ganske tydelig. Det finnes redskap og maskiner som gjør det mest utrolig, men akkurat den der arbeidsoperasjonen kan ikke forestille med noen verdens ting som kunne tatt og flyttet.
Later it appears that the same things had happened 2 years earlier further north in Norway, at Andøya, with precisely the same kind of cut and of exactly the same size. Was it the same phenomenon in operation? Was this the result of an unknown type of ball lightning, or was someone from another world gathering test material? In spite of the eyewitness reports of craft-like UFOs and signs of mysterious landings, the researchers decide to concentrate on the light observations. This is a part of the phenomena where they have managed to obtain solid measurements and reliable data. Could it be that the observations of objects are of a totally different kind, requiring a completely different type of approach?
Well, according to hadronic mechanics, that's a scientific and far-reaching revolution of the physics of century-old quantum mechanics and relativity theory, and nowadays also the
requiring a completely different type of approach.
Well, according to hadronic mechanics, that's a scientific and far-reaching revolution of the physics of century-old quantum mechanics and relativity theory, and nowadays also being unfolded in hadronic chemistry and technology, and new technologies. According to hadronic mechanics, there is no problem with space travel, and not even with the time travel, given certain circumstances and given certain kind of technology, but the physical laws for traveling through our 3D space with speeds far above the speed of light the equations and the physical models, concepts and relations for explaining this has been clear for more than 10 years in advanced hadronic mechanics.
During the 1990s, the frequency of observation slowly decreased. In the early 80s, 20 observations would be made in a week. 20 to 30 are now made per year. But the group of Norwegian enthusiasts continues their research. In 1994, Erling Strand and his colleagues organized the first international conference on the phenomenon in Hesdalen. Leading scientists arrived from 8 countries, including the USA, Russia and Japan.
Det ene jo at vi ønsker å diskutere selve fenomenet, og det andre jo hva vi skal gjøre med dette her for å finne en løsning.
Dere som interessert i det uforklarlige, hvordan blir dere mottatt i, skal vi kalle det, seriøse forskermiljøet i Norge?
Vi blir positivt mottatt, og de veldig interessert i dette her, så lenge det blir gjort på en riktig måte. Og må du huske på, en forsker, det jo en som skal finne ut noe av det ukjente.
The theory suggesting that the Hesdalen phenomena are generated by reflections from car lights, trains, or that they are in some way connected to TV and radio transmitters, are put to rest once and for all. This conference had one important consequence, that the phenomenon is now treated with more respect, and for the population in the Hesdalen Valley, this is a great relief.
I think fact very important in the future, especially in the practice. For example, you can use in this phenomenon like a container of energy, pure energy, not atomic energy, pure energy like hydrodynamic energy and maybe windly energy, electric energy.
In 1998, research in Hesdalen enters a new phase that was to prove historic. Supported by the Østfold University, the world's first 24/7 observatory for light phenomena is established in Hesdalen. With the generous help from one of the local farmers, a large, well-equipped container was placed on one side of the valley. Radar and instruments for measuring electromagnetic noises run continuously, along with video recorders that are activated as soon as unusual aerial movements are detected. Excitement is running high. Will it now be possible to capture the phenomenon on these new instruments?
Vi fikk opp denne her i august måned i 98, og da var det jo bare ett kamera her oppe. Og allerede etter noen dager så tok den sitt første fenomen.
Each minute the still cameras shoot overviews covering the valley and upload to the internet. Several observations of the phenomenon have been obtained from these cameras all year round. But what about the video cameras? After a year's tense wait, it finally happens. The Hesdalen phenomenon is caught on camera. Zooming in and slowing down the film shows something really astonishing. A second light seems to appear from underneath, joining the main light. How could this be interpreted? This footage brings the Hesdalen research to a new era.
Many people in Hesdalen municipality have seen the light phenomena in Hesdalen, and the community take it serious, and we are sure that there are something. But we don't know, and we want the scientists to be serious and try to find out what the light phenomena is.
We are at the Italian Center for Radio Astronomy in Medicina outside Bologna. The huge antennas are aimed at the stars. The scientists here are scanning the universe for sign of life. Conducted by the SETI program, search for extraterrestrial intelligence.
Well, we have recorded a huge amount of data so far, but unfortunately, we could not get any signal yet. Of course, we go on like that. We continue recording signals, we continue analyzing signals, hoping that one day something interesting can come out, of course.
After becoming aware of the Hestalm phenomenon, the Italian scientists traveled to Hestalm and had their own experience. From then on, they have supplied the Norwegian research team with valuable support. In Hestalm, the Italians have recently installed their own scientific instruments, including radar and electromagnetic measuring equipment.
Now we have installed here a VLF receiver. VLF stands for Very Low Frequency Receiver, in order to investigate on the phenomena that are happening in this valley.
The signals are received and analyzed at the Bologna Radio Astronomy Center.
So the data collected inside the blue box in Esdal and also inside the PEDR5 is sent every day automatically inside our server. After that, we start the processing of that.
So far, many interesting radar readings have been received from the lights, while photos have been taken simultaneously from the Norwegian observatory. In this way, data have been confirmed.
I would like to remember that this phenomena appear in several parts around the world, and of course is darling very interesting because from the statistical point of view appear several times. By the way, also in Italy, in Australia, USA, Thailand, and so on. So many parts of the world is interested in this kind of phenomena.
This phenomena could give us information about some kind of unknown form of energy. In my opinion, any kind of phenomena need to be unknown phenomena need to be investigated. This is the curiosity of the humankind.
A new container with more advanced instrumentation is being assembled in Italy and will soon be placed near the top of the Rogne mountain in Hestalen. This cooperative Hestalen Research Association HERA is also planning to establish a larger permanent observatory in the valley. This cooperation between the Østfold University and the Italians is an important incentive to research, now producing new amazing results.
I 2004 så var vi her i Hestdalen med studenter og forskere fra Italia, og hadde da bemannet flere forskningsbaser her, blant annet var det ene forskningsbasen på toppen av Rogne. Vi så da sydover i dalen her, og midt på natta, sånn ved 2-3 tida, så begynte det å skje ting. Det som hendte da var det at det så ut som det var et slags tett objekt. Det kunne se ut som en, kall det metallisk sky, som plutselig oppstod på et sted. Og så flytta det seg, og fem ganger så klarte vi å ta bilder av akkurat dette skjedde. Og det siste som skjedde med den metalliske skyen, det var på størrelsen av en låve. Så forsvant den, og så dukket den da opp som en sånn ildmørje. Rett etter det, så stoppet den ildmørja lyset, og så dukket det opp to lys. Det ene litt større enn det andre ved siden av hverandre, som krasjet rett i bakken, der borte. I det her skjedde, at den traff tretoppen der borte, så kom det ut en blå, spiralerende lysstrek, som føk bortover sånn. Den her blå lysstrålen,
Den treffer da toppen på et tre der borte. Og med en gang den treffer det, rett etterpå det, så forandrer den bølgelengden i hvordan den spiralerer bortover. Og da blir det mye lengre mellom hver topp og spiralen.
The results of the first 4 years of studies in cooperation with the Italians conclude that the phenomenon exists and is periodically active in Hestalen. The phenomenon is identified as a bright flying object with special characteristics making it unique to science. The phenomenon is more complex and diverse than expected, indicating more than one single kind of phenomenon. The phenomenon is sometimes made up of separate units that may depart and fly away. The speed varies from still to 8 kilometers per second. The phenomenon changes course in speeds indicating no mass by physical means. The phenomenon seems to be able to take on pieces of plasma or energy from the ground while passing by. The phenomenon seems to radiate energy due to the light and frequent change of color. Many interesting spectra in the optical and radio frequency range have been detected, but more data is needed to draw proper conclusions. These scientific data are quite sensational. We are dealing with a real existing phenomenon that can be observed and studied, even though this is difficult. But why Hestalen? What makes this remote valley different from other locations? Does it have anything to do with the existence of the massive mineral resources located in this area?
Kanskje Norges, et av Norges største malmfelt, malmressurser, ligger urørt der, hersefeltet. Jeg antyder av bergmesteren til å inneholde ca. 16 millioner tonn råmalm. Og det er vel kanskje tre ganger så mye malm som det Rørosfeltet og Killingdal drev på i 300 år. Da snakker vi om kopper og sink.
The 300-year-old copper mines in Røros, not far away, have connections to the Hestalen geological structures. In Hestalen we also find remains of iron mining, which dates as far back as to the Viking Age, 1,000 years ago. Could this massive concentration of minerals be linked to the phenomenon? But another mineral is also present here. Several old sulfur mines are located along the riverside, and some reports have been connected to this particular mineral.
Kom over Hestasjøen, så fikk vi se et lys på den andre siden til dalen, og vi så hele via, hele Hestalen over. Og da var det så nede, så vi kunne telle bjørkene på hele lia på Hestalen. Og så plutselig med at kom det så fæl lukt, det var rett svovel. Da var det opplyst i flere farver, begge sider av veien. All snøen var opplyst.
I 2004 så tok vi flere bilder etter hverandre på natta, hvor da Hestdalsfenomenet dukket opp over den posisjonen her hvor svovelgruva er lokalisert. Det var flere av disse som da var akkurat på samme sted, men startet da flere minutter etter hverandre. Så den gruva her, den er spesiell for Hestdalen.
But connecting the minerals in Hestdalen to the phenomenon is just another theory. The appearance of the phenomenon does not seem to follow any fixed patterns. In 2007, a large group of international scientists visit Hestalen as a part of a conference organized by the US-based Society for Scientific Exploration. Many of these experts and scientists study similar phenomena at other places in the world.
The lights of Hestalen are a fascinating phenomenon because they just arise over the ground. They're unpredictable whenever they arise. They're different shapes, different sizes, different intensities, and different durations. So it's quite a curious phenomena.
We have no explanation as to the cause at this time. It could be related to natural geophysical phenomena, earthquake precursors, earth lights. These are atmospheric disturbances. At this point, The jury is still out. We don't know. But that's part of it, the mystery. And that's why it's a good scientific subject.
Whether it is, as some people think, Earth-like, of geological origin, but I don't believe so from what I see as observations. I think it's much more complex. Is there a relation with UFOs? I do not know, but that's a question we have to solve. We do not have to believe this or that. We have to study it and to try to understand it.
This is a car driving. The camera shutter has been open for 30 seconds. So we have the spectrum from the car, but here we have the Hesdalen phenomena. Here.
At the conference, and for the first time ever, results of spectrum analysis of the phenomena are presented. They indicate that the lights contain elements of oxygen, nitrogen and silica, which in reality means air and dust. But there are also traces of the rare element scandium, found existent only in Scandinavia.
It's air and dust from Hesdalen that burns here. But it is some other kind of chemical elements inside it, this scandium.
Scandium is an extremely hard material and was used in the production of Soviet fighter planes.
It was very, very surprising to find scandium in it.
For å kunne få tak I forskningsdata så vi avhengig av masse folk. Bemanner flere forskningsstasjoner I fjellet, så vi har etablert et program som kalles for Science Camp, hvor vi involverer studenter og grunnskoleelever I opp til 14 dager, hvor vi bemanner forskningsstasjoner I fjellet. Og I september nå så hadde vi litt over 100 deltakere på en Science Camp som gikk en hel uke.
Det egentlig to innstillinger. Det det ene oppe her, den stille lysforsterkningen. Den forsterker egentlig lyset.
Og dette går jo veldig mye da på å få ungdommer interessert I naturen og I realfag, for å studere realfag ved senere. Så det jo rett og slett en, hva skal jeg si, motivasjonsfaktor vi ute og jobber med, altså.
Vi skal ta oss og måle sånn radioaktiv stråling I lufta, og så skal vi ta bilder utover dalen og se om vi får noen bilder av dere hestersfenomener.
Hovedpoenget med utstyret her jo å detektere noe som spesielt ved hestersfenomenet. Vi leter jo et eller annet som skiller dette lyset fra alt mulig annet. Så den første her, det kamerasystemet her, det tar bilder med veldig lang åpningstid, pluss at det har et spektralgitter foran, så vi kan få se et optisk spekter og få fingeravtrykket til fenomenet.
Så du det?
Ja, se, der det. Der det.
Der det. Synes du ute?
Der da! Hei, det beveger seg! Hei! Oi! Sjekk! Sjekk!
Vi har hatt et lysfenomen I peiling 312 grader, og det lyste I fjellsida I den retningen der innenfor et minutt.
Yes, this spectacular picture was shot from Rogne Mountain, approximately in 1000 meters altitude towards west, and it started to happen things at approximately 9:30 in the evening when the Aurora Borealis first show and then we suddenly had a lot of flashes in the valley and then some huge lights that suddenly turned out and moved with very high speed north-south in the valley and one spectacular happening was 1 minute before 10 in the evening. Then we had a big light that started out and moved very quickly north and south and gave us this very, very impressive picture, which possibly is the
best picture ever taken of the hairstyle phenomenon. The exposure time was 30 seconds. So we see that the hairstyle phenomenon moves from starts up here and moves down and then goes up again here. The distance here, it's approximately maybe from 10 to 15 kilometers, the distance it has covered. And the camera has an optical grating in front of the lens, and this grating make this optical spectrum here. The one thing that is that surprises us with this spectrum is that it's continuous. The colors goes directly over in the other color here, and we see no lines or dots here, which will give us a signal of that we have a gas that is burning. This looks like optical spectrum from a solid object, or from plasma with high density, or it could be molecular chemical compositions, because molecular optical bands have very, very narrow lines, and I think that our equipment has not the resolution to could differ the different lines here. So a molecular band could give us something that looks like a continuous spectra.
At the same time, this observation is registered on radar. While the lights were seen only for a few minutes, the radar readings show the phenomenon apparent for a total of 4 hours.
And we are also very curious about the Hesthalen phenomena, which looks like a burning ball of fire, that it doesn't expand. In a combustion process, things should expand, like in a motor in a car, but the phenomena keeps it in the same volume. It doesn't expand at all. So something must be able to hold this phenomena together, like a big magnetical field, like a plasmoid, an magnetic field which entraps plasma and keeps it inside itself. So we are looking for the mechanism that stores the energy, and why this energy source is so extremely powerful in the intensity. If this is a kind of a plasmoid, then we have a localized magnetical field that is able to encompass and keep a huge amount of energy, a plasma, inside a small ball for a long, long time. And this storing mechanism is one of the most interesting thing to find out on. And this storing mechanism could also be possibly a new way of storing energy instead of batteries, instead of petrol, instead of nuclear power. Maybe we in the atmosphere have a natural storing mechanism for energy which we never have been able to detect before.
The Hesthalen phenomenon is alive. The scientists claim to be on the verge of a revolution within physics. Can it be the energy source of the future we are looking at? The idea of extracting energy from thin air or vacuum is not new. As early as the 1920s, Nikola Tesla claimed to have discovered enormous energy potential in what he called the flux field, or the vacuum field. Today, science has named it zero-point energy. Until now, there is no known method of extracting this energy. Can this be what we see glimpses of in Hesthalen? Or is the phenomenon of a character challenging us to expand our conceptions of reality even further? Do the reports from locals in Hesthalen indicate that there is more to this than mystical energy alone? Many forefront physicists claim that we should reach for a totally new view on reality. If so, could Hesthalen be a portal to a different world?
We know there is a lot of energy in it. We have a lot of data, some indication on the power. And if we find out what this power is coming from, maybe we can use that power for the mankind. It can be, for instance, a clean power source. Who knows? We don't know yet. But if we do necessary research, we maybe can find an answer to that question. Can this be a new power which the mankind can be using?